Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Truth Is Still Out There, 30 Years of the X-Files, by Bethan Jones, narrated by Daniela Acitelli. Preface. I am writing this book in my office, drinking tea out of an X-Files mug with an I Want to Believe mouse mat next to my keyboard. Directly behind me, a cardboard cutout of Mulder and Scully rests against the wall, towering above several fan-made X-Files cushions, two of which are owls in the shape of Mulder and Scully. If I look to my right, I can see the abducted smoking alien sculpture from Jose Chung's From Outer Space, various boxed Powell's X-Files figures, and the 2016 Diamond Select Mulder and Scully action figures, both boxed. To my left, I have various academic books written about the series, dotted among other books about fan cultures, cult television, and reboots, the full set of Waller Customs X-Files Lego figures, and a screen-used prop spike from Darkness Falls, a 40th birthday present from my sister. In an alcove in my study, I have more shelving units and bookcases filled with X-Files-related memorabilia and merchandise. Original Topps comics share shelf space with copies of SFX magazine and Radio Times that feature articles on the show. Clippings from newspapers and magazines sit in a cardboard folder that sits on top of a binder containing the Topps trading cards. The original PS1 game is on a shelf, along with copies of the unrestricted access PC game, the VHS trivia game, and the 2015 IDW board game. Next to a shelf, containing the Fight the Future VHS Special Collector's Edition, the Fight the Future lunchbox, and the Fight the Future action figure set. Those, in turn, are next to a shelf containing a basketball signed by David Duchovny that was given as a crew gift at the end of Season 5, which is below a shelf containing the X-Files Funko Pop figures and a clapperboard signed by Chris Carter during the Season 10 revival. And that's to say nothing of the various t-shirts, jackets, bags, and caps that are in my wardrobe, or the posters and fan art that adorn my walls. This collection, amassed over the last 26 years, is a testament to how the show has helped define me and my life. My academic career was shaped by my involvement in the fandom. My third-year philosophy dissertation looked at reality and fiction in contemporary film and television, and I used Milagro and Jose Chung's From Outer Space as my case studies. My master's degree involved writing about fan fiction, something I've done since the days of the BBC cult message boards, and my PhD research involved surveying thousands of fans about the X-Files revival. Without the X-Files, my life would be very different, but I could never have seen that when the show began. The first season of The X-Files aired in 1994 here in the UK. When I was 12, and I didn't watch it. As a kid, I was already interested in the paranormal and read books about ghosts and the Loch Ness Monster, so I was skeptical about this new series. I read books by Isaac Asimov and Arthur C. Clarke, inspired by my granddad's library, and I was determined to be a parapsychologist when I grew up. This new series was bound to be silly and inferior and poke fun at those of us genuinely interested in the paranormal. I wasn't going to watch it. But my stepfather did. And one evening, I walked into the living room while it was on. I was hooked. I can't tell you why. It might have been the chemistry between David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson. It might have been that it was nothing like any other show I'd seen up to that point. Regardless, I dove headfirst into the fandom, and I've been a part of it ever since. One of the entries in a diary I kept when I was 14 reads, "Mom said The X-Files is just a TV show. What does she know?" I think for a lot of us, The X-Files is more than just a TV show. It's a cult hit that changed the way stories on television were told. It spawned a massive fandom that utilized the emerging technology of the internet, and it was able to capture the paranoia of the early 90s as well as reflect the changing times of the 21st century. Part history, part critical analysis, part love letter, this book attempts to capture all of that. I hope you will enjoy the chapters that follow, that they will make you think, reflect, and laugh, and that you'll forgive any mistakes. Bethan Jones, January 2023. Introduction. Why are people still watching a 30-year-old TV show? John Doggett, Sunshine Days. The question that opens this chapter is posed by Federal Bureau of Investigation Special Agent John Doggett in the Season 9 episode Sunshine Days. In the episode, it's asked about the Brady Bunch as Doggett, Scully, and Reyes investigate a murder suspect obsessed with the show. But it's a question also relevant to the X-Files. Created by Chris Carter and premiering in 1993, the show ended in 2002 after declining viewing figures and a disappointing two seasons. While it was revived in 2016 following a long-running fan campaign, the success of the original nine seasons meant the show had become part of the cultural consciousness beyond the realm of fandom. It's rare that a TV show captures the public attention to this extent, or is referred to in so many other pieces of media. Off the top of my head, I think of Star Trek, Star Wars, The Simpsons, and maybe Friends as other examples of film or TV, in the West at least, that are regularly quoted and recognized years after they first aired. Say to someone, "Live long and prosper," or "I am your father," and they're likely to know where the reference is from. The truth is out there, and trust no one, two of the X-Files' most iconic mottos, are regularly used in news articles and think pieces, and Mark Snow's distinctive theme tune, with its six-note whistle, has become a shortcut for highlighting the unexplained and weird, drawing yet another link between the X-Files and the Twilight Zone, whose four-note theme still evokes the uncanny and terrifying. During its original run, and for years afterward, The X-Files has been referenced in other media texts. Mulder and Scully appeared in the Springfield Files episode of The Simpsons in 1997, and were referenced in the 2005 pilot episode of Bones, as well as in Breaking Bad. Created by X-Files alumnus Vince Gilligan. More recently, its appearance in the 2022 episode of Only Murders in the Building, Flipping the Pieces, demonstrated the show's continuing relevance. But why the X-Files, and not any of the other shows that debuted in 1993? I think there are a few reasons for this, including the connection between Mulder and Scully, played to critical acclaim by David Duchovny and Gillian Anderson, the dedicated fan base, and the show's ability to tap into the big questions of its time, perhaps more pertinent in 2016 than ever before. When rumors began circulating about the possible return of the X-Files, the response from fans was, understandably, mixed. Some of these responses reflected on the final two seasons of the show and the disappointing 2008 film I Want to Believe. One fan who responded to a questionnaire I posted online as part of my PhD research wrote, "Chris Carter has proven through the final season of the series and the series finale and the 2008 movie and his handling of the Mulder and Scully characters and their relationship, that he is clearly unable to recapture what made the X-Files successful so many years ago. I don't hold out hope that Carter will be able to pull off anything that even comes close to what the series did and made me feel in the first five seasons." Other responses, however, reflected on the ways in which politics, culture, and society had changed in the years since the show had ended, and questioned whether The X-Files was still relevant. One fan wrote, "It was a good show that struck a cultural nerve when it came out, but that time has passed." In some ways, these fans were right. The world in 2016 was radically different from the world in 2002. The U.S. had seen a move from a Republican president to a Democrat, who also happened to be the first black president. Global migration had increased as a result of violence and political instability, seeing a corresponding increase in anti-immigrant rhetoric, and technology had advanced at an exponential rate. Also emerging in the 2000s and 2010s were a growing distrust of government and an evolution of conspiracy thinking. Some of the fans who responded to my survey questioned whether the show could really find a place in this new era. With one writing, "The X-Files was really a product of its time. After the Second Iraq War and W's bullshit and Edward Snowden's revelations, I don't think many people find government conspiracies and lies all that far-fetched." I shrug at the myth arc these days. It's so cute. And to some extent, who can blame them for that response? The idea that the U.S. government was hiding the existence of extraterrestrial life from the population does seem rather naive when we consider the very real cover-ups that have been exposed over the last decade or so. Yet many others, explicitly referring to the paranoia, conspiracy theories, and politics of the original show, felt that those themes were perfect for the contemporary climate. An unsure time, politically, socially, economically, and technologically. Another fan wrote, "Times have changed since the show went off the air in 2002. I'd like to see how Chris Carter and the other writers do a 21st century X-Files. After all that has gone on with post-9/11 counterterrorism, WikiLeaks and Edward Snowden, technology advances, social media, and more. What do people fear now? What is the tension between paranoia and skepticism in modern society? How much trust is there of government and other institutions?" These are all questions I suggest over the course of this book that The X-Files continues to address. While skepticism and distrust of the government certainly existed during the show's original run, fundamental changes within society meant that the revival seasons would need to deal with these in markedly different ways. The first decade of the 21st century saw the financial crash of 2008, which led to increasing political instability, economic austerity, and a further polarization between left and the right across the globe, topics that seemed as pertinent to the show's concerns as the end of the Reagan presidency and the Cold War were to the original seasons, discussed in Chapter 1. Although some viewers weren't sure if the revival would be able to adapt to a new landscape, many others, me included, felt that the themes the show originally dealt with were just as relevant. One fan wrote, "I think this is the perfect political climate for this revival to occur. The subject of the show is relevant now in ways that it might not necessarily have been since the release of I Want to Believe." Another felt that, "Now, in a time of government spying and a new wave of disenchantment with the government and authority, the show is more relevant than ever." And these were ideas that Carter had actually been toying with for some time. In an interview with the Guardian newspaper, he highlighted the use of surveillance by the government as an influence for Season 10, saying, "We were trying to be honest with the changes dealing with digital technology, the capability of spying. Clearly, we're being spied on in the U.S., or at least spying on you, and there seems to be no shame in it." He also noted the political changes and the way the show dealt with them in an interview with Bustle, saying, "So much has changed politically since 1993. Radical changes to 2001. Radical changes through the Obama years. And even more radical change with President Trump. So The X-Files has gotten to deal with a lot of political realities, and I'll always think it's given the show a lot of its life. The political realities are part of the way we think about the show. But we're not responding to the political reality the way shows like American Horror Story, Cult, are, where they're taking it head on. Those new political realities were referred to at various points throughout the season, though. In this, Assistant Director Walter Skinner is refused assistance from the executive branch of the FBI because the Bureau's not in good standing with the White House. In Plus One, we see the real-world conflict between a nameless president, Donald Trump, and the FBI, with Mulder telling Scully that the world is going to hell with the president working to bring down the FBI along with it. Perhaps most pertinently, though, we see the changing politics and the continued threat of a shadow government that poses a danger to democracy around the globe. The opening montage of My Struggle 3 includes footage of Trump's inauguration, Black Lives Matter protests, Vladimir Putin, and robed Ku Klux Klan members beneath a voiceover from cigarette-smoking man who places himself at the center of the shadow government, making sacrifices few are capable of which even fewer are willing. Parceling out the truth, which is held only by the few who know the levers of power. This statement draws parallels to the QAnon movement that emerged in late 2017, discussed in chapters 3 and 6, and that argues that a secret cabal of Satan-worshipping child molesters poses a threat to global democracy. Donald Trump is the only person who could stop them, and the anonymous Q, who claims to be a high-ranking government official with access to classified information, parcels out snippets of information relating to this and encourages followers to reject any government officials other than Trump, the mainstream media, and medical experts. QAnon developed from a conspiracy theory into a political movement, with followers appearing at Trump's re-election campaign rallies, Republican representatives failing to condemn, some even endorsing, the movement and its claims, and Trump and his allies attempting to overturn the results of the 2020 presidential election. This expansion of conspiracy theories into the mainstream seems a perfect opportunity for a revival of the X-Files. Conspiracy theorists in the 1990s were like the lone gunman, radical misfits, counterculturalists, and computer hackers who don't work but are financed by backers who believe in the cause. The lone gunman, comprising Richard Ringo Langley, Melvin Frohike, and John Fitzgerald Byers, are on the fringes of society. They share a loft apartment that also functions as their office, rely on a 1974-79 VW transporter to get around, and are often ridiculed for their beliefs. Even Scully, after their first meeting in EBE, tells Mulder, "Those were the most paranoid people I have ever met. I don't know how you could think that what they say is even remotely plausible." Fast forward to the 21st century, and conspiracy theorists are more akin to Tad O'Malley than Frohike, Langley, and Byers. When we first meet O'Malley, the host of a right-wing talk show in My Struggle, he's in a black stretch limo, fully bulletproofed, with a bottle of Louis Montreal champagne chilling on ice. Later in the episode, he arrives at Mulder's house in a helicopter. As Mulder points out, conspiracy sells and has made O'Malley a very rich man. This mainstreaming of conspiracy is perhaps one of the biggest changes the show has had to contend with. Discussing season 10, Carter says he kept his finger to the wind and tried to figure out what was relevant and possible. People know the show deals with science and fact, and also deals with far-flung theories about not only the supernatural, but government conspiracies. It throws out as many questions as it does answers. And I have to say that what the conspiracy world has done for me and the writers, it has given us a whole new open field in which to run. It's given the show an interesting new life and context that it might not have had in 2002. This context deals not only with the mainstreaming of conspiracy theories, but also the changing ways in which they circulate. The lone gunman had an underground newsletter called The Magic Bullet, circulated as hard copies to their subscribers. Conspiracy theorists now have websites, Twitter accounts, Facebook pages, and YouTube channels through which they can spread their message. This passage of time and technology is brought front and center in the revival seasons. In My Struggle, O'Malley refers to dirt boxes, recording conversations he would rather remain private, something Carter's production company, 1013 Productions, had to contend with in shooting the series. During one shoot, where they were filming green screenshots in a limousine, an aircraft was circling, which disrupted the shoot. While in The Lost Art of Forehead Sweat, online disinformation is highlighted as a major 21st century concern, discussed more in Chapter 6. Advances in technology were some of the key things fans mentioned in the questionnaire I circulated prior to Season 10 airing, with many excited about the possibilities new technology could bring to the storylines. In fact, technology was a staple throughout the revival seasons, and not just in relation to conspiracy theories. Mulder and Scully meet the were-monster acknowledges the changing context most explicitly, riffing on the idea that those of an older generation struggle with new technology, with Mulder unable to make his new smartphone work and obtaining a grainy photograph of the monster's ear, or possibly its foot. This depicts some of the ethical quandaries of modern technology, with Langley, whose consciousness is uploaded into a simulation that would come to life when he dies, warning Mulder and Scully that the virtual world is akin to an eternal prison with no escape. RM9SBG93ZXJZ warns about the dangers of artificial intelligence as Mulder and Scully eat at a fully automated restaurant before experiencing a range of increasingly dangerous interactions with artificially intelligent technology. The episode draws on the real-life example of a Microsoft chatbot designed to learn from human interactions that was shut down a day after it was released on Twitter because it had learned to post racist and sexist messages. Carter and his co-producers made sure that The X-Files was able to tell stories that reflected the mid-2010s. From conspiracy theories to the nature of truth to smartphones, and viewers responded positively. The first episode of Season 10 earned over 16 million viewers in the U.S. based on live and same-day ratings, going up to 21.47 million when taking into account seven-day catch-up figures. Fox's assumption that reviving the series because it would be a rating success seemed to have been proved right. So why are we still watching a 30-year-old TV show? While I've talked about how seasons 10 and 11 bring some of the themes of the earlier seasons up to date for a 21st century audience, what I haven't answered is why we're still watching. It is, in part, because Mulder and Scully are iconic leads who broke the mold, and also because the stories themselves are compelling. But more than that, I think the reason we keep coming back to the show is because of what it tells us about the time we're living in. The X-Files deals with the big questions. What is true? Whom can we trust? What kind of society do we want to live in? Is faith enough? And it does so in a way that speaks to the contemporary climate. When the series began, the effects of Watergate in Vietnam on the American population had been compounded by concerns about the approaching millennium and a move away from traditional religion. Now the world is concerned with fake news and disinformation. The paranoia and distrust is still there, but it has a different cause. The X-Files highlights that, sometimes in ways that seem scarily prescient. As I watched the original series again while writing this book, the only thing that seemed dated was the technology. And yes, okay, Scully's pantsuits. Scully uses a desktop PC with a chunky CRT monitor to type up her field notes, Mulder turns to a phone book to find Skyland Mountain rather than using Google Maps. Yet the cases they deal with, the questions they seek to answer, are ultimately timeless. The rest of this book looks at some of the big issues the X-Files has dealt with over the course of its 11 seasons, as well as the way it has shaped the television landscape and the impact of the fandom. In writing this, I have attempted to speak to multiple readers, from the files who watched the show when it first aired, to new fans who discovered the series on Netflix or via social media. To that end, I've tried to combine broad-brush history with more detailed analyses, covering all iterations of the show. For some listeners, the impact of the Cold War on Carter or the influence Scully has had on generations of women may be old news. But for others, who perhaps aren't as familiar with the reams of articles and books written about the show, these insights might help give more context to the show and its enduring legacy. There are, of course, too many topics to address in one book, and you'll see references to other works that deal with some of these in more depth throughout the chapters. What I've done is divide the book into four sections that focus on the themes I think are most relevant, and I've structured these around the different eras of the show: the Vancouver years, the Los Angeles years, and the revival years. This isn't an arbitrary decision. The Vancouver years make excellent use of the locations in British Columbia to set the tone of the episodes in the overall series. It's dark, wooded, some might say gloomy. I'm not going to comment on the weather. When David Duchovny complained about the 400 inches of rainfall a day in 1997, he incurred the wrath of thousands of the city's residents, and you can easily imagine some genetic throwback hiding in the trees. Kathy Johnson points out that the series has a signature style that doesn't show the audience too much. John Bartley, director of photography on the first three seasons, described the show's style as dark, moody, mysterious, and sometimes claustrophobic, and it's easy to see how Vancouver helped create this feel. Season 5 was originally planned to end the television series. The finale intended to transition the show into a film franchise. L.A., where filming moved in 1998, ahead of season 6, represented a new era for the series in terms of both storytelling and tone. While season 5 ends in a typically dark, burned-out basement office, lit only by the flashing of emergency lights, season 6 opens with a blazing sun in a bright blue sky, a feature that becomes as much a part of the L.A. years as the Vancouver landscape did in the first five seasons. The lighting and landscape in Drive, The Rain King, and Arcadia is worlds away from those in episodes like The Pilot, War of the Coprophages, and Detour. But the storytelling also changes. As Darren Mooney points out, Triangle, the third episode of the season, marked something of a shift that set the tone for the season, which featured multiple quirky and comedic episodes hinting at a romantic relationship between Mulder and Scully. But just as the world inside the show was changing, so too was the world outside. With the millennium fast approaching, concerns abounded about a global computer malfunction, while the terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001 shook the country to its core and led to increasing faith in the government, although the anti-terrorism steps the Bush administration took to increasing suspicion in some circles. The ninth season was the last for the original iteration of the shows. After 202 episodes and one movie, The X-Files appeared to be out of step with the mood of the country. Although the revival years technically begin with 2008's I Want to Believe, I mostly discuss seasons 10 and 11, a standalone monster of the week narrative that didn't do that well in the box office. It would have been better suited for an autumn-winter release rather than the summer, when it had to compete with blockbusters like The Dark Knight. The film seemed unable to find a way to match the mood of the time, just like the final two seasons of the show years earlier. What really interests me in this era is how seasons 10 and 11 tapped into the politics, fears, and paranoia of the 2010s. The show returned to Vancouver to film, giving us its original distinctive style, but updated to take into account smartphones, drones, and an increasing division between the ideals of left and right. Section 1, Trust No One, focuses on politics, looking at conspiracy culture over the last three decades and the question of whom we can trust. Chapter 1 explores the initial impetus for the series, Watergate, the Cold War, and Vietnam, while Chapter 2 examines the decline in viewers, the X-Files encountered in its final four seasons, and the effect that the change in attitudes toward the government following the September 11th attacks had on the show. Chapter 3 brings us up to the revival years. In the context of Brexit, the Trump presidency, and the rise of QAnon. Section 2, The Truth is Out There, takes a philosophical look at the series and what truth means in the context of The X-Files. The truth might be out there, but what exactly is it? How do we know it when we find it, and does it even matter anymore? Chapter 4 analyzes Jose Chung's From Outer Space and what the episode tells us about the nature of truth in both Class County and in the wider show. Chapter 5 examines faith and belief in the context of religion, especially in Season 7, and asks whether the truth can be found not in science or doctrine, but in other people. Chapter 6 returns to a specific episode, this time analyzing the rise in fake news and disinformation following 9/11, and how that is addressed in the increasingly post-truth environment that The Lost Art of Forehead Sweat so satirically deals with. Section 3, I Want to Believe, examines the cultural contexts of The X-Files and some of the ways in which the show began to shape society as much as society shaped the show. Chapter 7 focuses on the way the show depicts gender and the subversion of gender expectations in the characters of Mulder and Scully, while Chapter 8 expands on this to examine how Scully inspired a generation of young girls to take up careers in science, technology, engineering, and medicine. Chapter 9 brings us up to the 21st century and how our understanding of gender and sexuality has changed, asking whether the X-Files changed along with it. Section 4, Deny Everything, takes us beyond the show itself to look at its impact on television, the growing franchise, and the show's fandom. Chapter 10 reflects on the impact the X-Files had on television more broadly, highlighting the producers and writers who have gone on to create some of the most acclaimed series in this latest golden age of television. Chapter 11 examines the franchise beyond the small screen. Fox, aware of the hit it had on its hands, expanded the story into spin-off shows, books, comics, and games, all of which allowed new entry points into the X-Files universe for new audiences and new ways for fans to engage with Mulder and Scully. Chapter 12 turns to the fandom at large, discussing the ways in which the history of the fandom is entwined with the history of the show itself, and how fans of The X-Files have also had an impact on the real world. Finally, the conclusion reflects on some of the main themes and arguments made in the course of the book. It also asks what might happen now that Disney has acquired Fox, and what the future might hold for The X-Files, a show with a history of transmedia storytelling and a large and dedicated fan base. But first, let's go back to the beginning. Section 1. Trust No One. Chapter 1. Aliens, Watergate, and the Death of Trust. What makes you think this is a conspiracy, that the government's involved? Scully, Memento Mori. The X-Files is built on conspiracies. While the show's most famous motto might be, "The truth is out there," its underlying principle is to trust no one. We see this in the very first episode. In his efforts to find out what really happened to his sister, Samantha, Mulder discovers the existence of a global conspiracy to colonize Earth. Scully is sent to debunk Mulder's ideas and discredit him, given the risks he poses to the project. In one of the most iconic scenes of the series, we see Scully enter the X-Files basement home and approach Mulder, where the following exchange takes place. Scully. Agent Mulder, I'm Dana Scully. I've been assigned to work with you. Mulder. Oh, isn't it nice to be suddenly so highly regarded? So who did you tick off to get stuck with this detail, Scully? Scully. Actually, I'm looking forward to working with you. I've heard a lot about you. Mulder. Oh, really? I was under the impression that you were sent to spy on me. Scully immediately offers her qualifications, but these aren't what will make Mulder trust her. They're not always necessary in this line of work. The X-Files' focus on aliens and the paranormal is a large part of the show's success and a testament to Carter's understanding of the cultural moment at the time. David Lavery, Angela Haig, and Maria Cartwright, editors of one of the first academic books on the show, point out that the American public's interest with UFOs, which began with the Roswell incident in 1947, transformed into a fascination with abduction that linked the X-Files to a larger cultural and historical context. B-movies like Invasion of the Body Snatchers, 1956, and The Thing from Another World, 1951, had introduced audiences to the idea of alien invasion, while books such as John Fuller's The Interrupted Journey, 1966, and Whitley Strieber's Communion, 1987, had suggested a more personal and invasive encounter. The X-Files took this one step farther, combining the most terrifying aspects of paranormal experience with various cultural elements, science fiction, New Age obsessions with channeling, reincarnation, near-death experiences, and spiritual advancement, Byzantine government conspiracy stories, which include secret medical experiments upon unsuspecting citizens and concerns with sexual abuse and genetic engineering, an increase in tabloid stories, TV shows and magazines dedicated to the paranormal seemed to spring up in the late 1980s and 1990s. Certainly I was interested in the paranormal before I began watching the show. One of the books I remember as a kid was about unexplained phenomena like the Loch Ness Monster and extrasensory perception, and I was fascinated by those topics. The paranormal and the supernatural seemed to proliferate on television during the 80s and 90s, although science fiction series like Star Trek, Doctor Who, and The $6 Million Man had been relatively popular since the 1960s, these offered a more optimistic approach to the genre than the more ominous series that followed, such as The Invaders, a paranoid show about alien invasion that aired for two seasons in the late 60s and whose lead actor, Roy Thines, played alien rebel Jeremiah Smith in The X-Files. Aaron John Gulyas, in his book The Paranormal and the Paranoid, points out that the X-Files didn't emerge in a vacuum, highlighting the history of alien contact science fiction television and films that became popular in the 1950s. The series further adopted elements of the paranormal, extraterrestrial, and conspiratorial culture that had developed in the 1970s. Shows like Call Jack the Night Stalker and Project UFO used specific paranormal incidents as inspiration for episodes, while films including The Conversation, 1974, The Parallax View, 1974, 3 Days of the Condor, 1975, and All the President's Men, 1976, brought paranoia and conspiracy onto the big screen. Documentary series like In Search Of, which began as 3-hour-long specials, including one inspired by Eric von Däniken's 1968 book, Chariots of the Gods, Unsolved Mysteries of the Past, presented casual television viewers with a wide variety of supernatural and conspiratorial topics, ranging from alien abductions to the Loch Ness Monster, while also familiarizing viewers with the allegedly factual basis of many of the foundational stories and myths of the paranormal, especially those connected with UFOs and belief in alien visitation and abduction. Figures like Whitley Strieber, whose book about his abduction experiences was published in 1987, Uri Geller, who became famous for his apparent psychokinetic powers and telepathy, and David Icke, a British conspiracy theorist who claimed that an interdimensional race of reptilian beings had hijacked Earth, were also featured prominently on television in the 1990s, further mainstreaming various conspiracy and paranormal theories. But if the focus on the paranormal was indicative of the cultural moment of the early 1990s, its underlying themes of distrust and paranoia dated back to earlier cultural events in the U.S. One of the key inspirations for the show, and an event that had a huge impact on Carter himself, was the Watergate scandal. The arrest of several burglars who had broken into the Democratic National Committee office in the Watergate building led to the resignation of President Richard Nixon when it was revealed that the burglars were linked to his re-election committee, and he had not only taken steps to cover up the crime, but also swore to the public that none of his staff had been involved. Nixon was re-elected in a landslide victory after making that speech. But the fact that he had lied to the electorate resulted in many Americans losing faith in their government. Talking to the New York Daily News, Carter said, "I was about 15 or 16 years old when Watergate happened, and I think that ruined me forever as far as my belief in institutions and in authority and agendas of government." Despite the fact it took place 20 years before the pilot of the X-Files episode aired, Watergate reverberated through the first 9 seasons of the show. Mulder's first informant, Deep Throat, was inspired by the real-life Deep Throat, who leaked information on the Watergate scandal to Washington Post reporter Bob Woodward, and who was finally revealed in 2005 to be Mark Felt, an assistant FBI associate director.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.